So over to you, sir.
Good afternoon. At the outset, I'd like to thank Professor Maheshwari and Dr. Professor Panda for inviting me to speak on this topic, a very typical clinical topic after all the discussions we have had so far. Diagnosing amyloidosis, what you need is a clinical suspicion. So going back to our old days, what is amyloidosis? It's nothing but aggregates of misfolded proteins, amyloid proteins, which gets deposited in organs. And the deposition may be localized, that's at sites of synthesis, or it may be systemic, that is at distant sites of synthesis. Localized commonest one is Alzheimer's disease and obviously the myeloma. And the distant ones would include the triethylamine produced in the liver, which causes the amyloidosis, or the immunoglobulin-like change that are produced in the bone marrow. Now, coming to the chemical nature, it's a pentagonal molecule composed of 95% of protein fibril and 5% glycoprotein precomponent. And these fibrils form protein subunits, which form a beta-pleated sheet structure. You can see it very well in this photograph. And the typical finding is apple green birefringence seen under polarized light when stained by Congo red. And this Congo red positivity is mandatory for the diagnosis of AL amyloidosis, but biopsy is not necessary for the diagnosis of cardiac ATTR amyloidosis. Coming to the classification, systemic amyloidosis subclassified into primary and secondary, or the localized amyloidosis, which may include the senile cerebral, senile cardiac, or type 2 diabetes. Primary systemic amyloidosis, the AL type from the multiple myeloma composed of light chains, or the AA type, very much prevalent in India, precursor being SAA, which leads to chronic inflammatory diseases. Also the alpha B2 microglobin in dialysis patients, hemodialysis patients. Types of systemic amyloidosis, the immunoglobulin light chain AL, the mutant transthyretin MATTR, wild type transthyretin, reactive fibrinogen, and the apolipoprotein A1. Systemic amyloidosis may be hereditary or acquired. AL amyloidosis and the wild type amyloidosis are acquired systemic amyloidosis. Now, common amyloidosis. The most common amyloidosis in the developed nations is the AL amyloidosis, while in India or in the developing countries is the other one, that's the AA amyloidosis. Incidence is very low, only 9 to 14 per million person years. Obviously, there's a lot of underdiagnosis and prevalence may be much higher. Incidence of AL amyloidosis was only 1.2 per 1 lakh person years, and it has remained static between 1990 and 2015. So you can obviously understand there's a lot of underdiagnosis. The incidence of early AL amyloidosis and the ATTR amyloidosis rises with age. Coming to systemic AL amyloidosis, unlike multiple myeloma, the death in amyloidosis is due to the toxic monoclonal proteins which get deposited in the vital organs of the body, and the cardiac function determines the survival. The hallmark of systemic AL amyloidosis is plasma cell that secretes light chains, and in less than 2% of AL amyloidosis patients, routine lab testing may not be effective. That is, it may not be sensitive enough to detect the light chains, or the light chain burden may be low. And these rare cases pose a diagnostic challenge. AA amyloidosis, the commonest amyloidosis present in India. These AA amyloid proteins result from a proteolytic cleavage of the SAA protein. And SAA is obviously, as you know, it's an acute phase reactant produced by the liver. Acquired and hereditary diseases can lead to AA amyloidosis. And the commonest diseases which lead to this AA amyloidosis are the rheumatoid arthritis, chronic inflammatory bowel disease, tuberculosis, bronchiectasis, etc. Coming to ATTR amyloidosis, it's a systemic progressive amyloidosis that can be divided into two subtypes. The ATTRM, that's an ATTR mutant type, which is an autosomal dominant inherited disease in which there is a replacement of a single amino acid in the protein, and the ATTR-WT, that's the wild type, previously called senile amyloidosis, caused by an intrinsic propensity to assume a pathological conformation that typically occurs in the elderly. Delayed diagnosis, as I said, is very common in amyloidosis. So what should we do? We should go for increased awareness amongst the physicians and also, if possible, among the patients. The median time to diagnosis is 7 months. In 37% of patients, diagnosis may be delayed by over a year, and over 10% diagnosed more than 3 years after presentation. That's a big interval. Early awareness that amyloidosis is the cause of organ dysfunction may lead to the use of surrogate site biopsies, such as fat pad aspiration from the abdomen, instead of going for riskier organ biopsies. Clinical manifestations, amyloidosis is the great mediator, and the symptoms and signs would depend on the organ involved. Any organ may be involved except for the brain parenchyma, and the affected organs predominantly include the heart, kidney, and third comes the GI system, as also the other organs may be involved. A third of the patients have only one affected organ, while most have several. Common clinical scenarios that should elicit suspicion for amyloidosis are non-diabetic nephrotic range proteinuria, cardiac failure with LV hypertrophy, but without aortic stenosis or hypertension, peripheral or autonomic neuropathy with an obvious cause, without any obvious cause, or chronic inflammatory demyelinating polyneuropathy, that's CIDP with autonomic features, hepatomegaly with an elevated ALP, and obviously there may be macroglossia or periorbital purpura, which may be pathognomonic but found in very few cases, less than 10%. But they may point to a diagnosis of amyloidosis. Diagnostic clues. For the heart, the ECG may show low voltage complexes, poor ROI progression in chest leads, the NT-prone BNP would be more than 332 nanogram per liter. ECHO shows thickened left and right atria, as well as the thickened left and right ventricles. The left ventricular thickness is more than 12 mm, and MRI shows diffuse subendocardial late gadolinium enhancement. Kidney involvement is reflected by the protein markers, that's 24-hour protein more than 500 milligram per day, and it's predominantly albumin. But typically in an amyloid patient, we'll also find peripheral edema and the features of nephrotic syndrome. GI tract involvement, difficult to diagnose as the symptoms are very fluid and may overlap with other diseases. But GI tract involvement has two peculiar manifestations, that's low albumin and anemia. Liver involvement is shown by the increased liver span of more than 15 centimeters in the absence of heart failure, ALP elevation, increased prothrombin time, and the partial thrombopoietin time, which are due to low factor 10 levels. Howell Jolly bodies in peripheral smear points to the involvement of the spleen, and CT showing interstitial pattern in the absence of pulmonary edema should raise the suspicion of amyloidosis in the lungs. ATTR wild-type patients are 90% male. They usually have cardiac involvement, but without renal involvement. Thus, ATTR WT wild-type are perhaps the only few patients who do not have renal involvement. Almost all other patients of amyloidosis do have a renal involvement. 50% have a history of carpal tunnel syndrome, and the finding of spontaneous rupture of the head of the biceps tendon should elicit the suspicion of ATTR WT amyloidosis. Also, there may be spinal stenosis or recurrent trigger finger. Family history is obviously of utmost importance. Now, coming to amyloid subtypes according to the involved organs, the light chain amyloidosis, in which there is overproduction of light chains by clonal plasma cells in the bone marrow, and the affected organs are heart, kidney, nerve, GI, liver, or soft tissue. The heavy chain amyloidosis, overproduction of amyloidogenic heavy proteins by clonal plasma cells in the bone marrow. Affected organs are heart, kidney, or the liver. The ATTR wild-type amyloidosis due to the deposition of transthyretin in the heart, soft tissue, or nerve. ATTR mutant amyloidosis caused by mutation in the transthyretin Again, the deposition is in the heart, kidney, soft tissue, or nerve. E amyloidosis is due to overproduction of serum amyloid A protein due to chronic inflammation. Again, the disease, organs involved are kidney, liver, or the spleen. Now coming to cardiac involvement. Usually, it's a restrictive cardiomyopathy type of picture with a diastolic failure. The normal symptoms of heart failure are present, and the commonest differentials would be ischemic cardiomyopathy or the aortic stenosis. ECG shows a typical pseudo-infarct pattern and may lead to coronary angiography, which is obviously negative. There may be low voltage in ECG found in 50% of patients, and such patients often present with syncope, arrhythmia, or sudden cardiac death. Rarely, amyloid deposition in coronary arterioles may lead to myocardial infarction and cardiogenic shock. Echocardiography shows thickened walls, as I told earlier. There may be classical granular spotty appearance on echo, though often not seen. Noble longitudinal strain has good accuracy in detecting cardiac involvement. Diffuse subendocardial late gadolinium enhancement of cardiac MRI is a sensitive marker, but please remember a normal MRI or a normal echo may not exclude amyloidosis. Scintigraphy using pyrophosphate or the 3,3-diphosphono-1,2 propanodicarboxylic acid labeled with 99 technetium is gaining increasing popularity and forms an integral part of the diagnostic workup of ATTR amyloidosis with more than 99% sensitivity and 68% specificity. These nuclear scans are now widely available and are non-invasive. They are used to differentiate ATTR amyloidosis from AL amyloidosis. Grade 2 or 3 positive scans obviously exclude AL amyloidosis, but we should remember that 30% of AL amyloidosis patients have weak positive PIP scans. Normal free light chain assays in the blood and negative immunofixation serum and urine. The combined finding of grade 2 or 3 peritoneal scare or score on scintigraphy and the absence of monoclonal protein in serum and urine points to 100% specificity for the presence of cardiac ATTR amyloid. Renal involvement, foamy urine. As seen in diabetics, there may be renal involvement with non-selective proteinuria, as told earlier. One third of the patients with amyloidosis have nephrotic syndrome manifested by a dramatic increase in the blood cholesterol level, and the urine analysis for protein should be made in patients with a sudden increase in serum cholesterol levels. Enlarged kidneys are typical but rarely seen. Nervous system usually involvement usually starts with the peripheral neuropathy in the lower extremities. It's symmetrical, maybe anticoagulable with diabetes. EMD may miss amyloid-induced neuropathy when only small fibers are involved. And in these cases, we may go for a skin biopsy for quantification. EMD findings of prolonged distal motor latencies may lead to a misdiagnosis of CIDP. Carpenter-Tunnel syndrome found in 10 to 15% of patients and may antedate the diagnosis of amyloidosis by a decade in ATTR amyloidosis and the AL amyloidosis. In amyloidosis, CTC, that is the cardiac carpal tunnel syndrome, is usually bilateral and the release operation is usually not helpful. But it may point to early diagnosis of amyloidosis. In a prospect trial where 98 patients were evaluated, 10 patients had a positive congruent staining. These led to early diagnosis of amyloidosis. Nervous system, autonomic neuropathy may present with orthostatic hypotension. Dysmenorrhea of bowel with pseudo-obstruction, alternative constipation or diarrhea. There may be lifestyle dysfunction. Peripheral neuropathy may be present with or without autonomic neuropathy, and obviously the neurogenic matter. Macroglossia is typical, though rarely seen. There may be dental indentation. Macroglossia only seen in AL amyloidosis. And of another nail skin manifestation, that's nail dystrophy, may antedate the diagnosis of amyloidosis by years. These are the clinical manifestations we should remember. They are pathognomonic, though rarely seen. Macroglossia, racuna panda sign by periorbital purpura, a shoulder pad sign, gross lymphadenopathy, or the waxy intradermal amyloid deposition.
Sir, please conclude, sir.
Yes, two slides more. Periorbital purpura, classical sign is shown due to vascular fragility. Small vessel disease may be present, or there may be temporal artery involvement. Do not confuse with GI, giant cell arteritis. I'm skipping the other manifestations. Only these hematological manifestations lead to easy bruising due to PT and PTG prolongation, levels of factor 10 may rise with effective therapy. And these other coagulation factor deficiency may lead to, as seen in liver disease, amyloid infiltration in blood vessels, and acquired von Willebrand disease. Localized amyloidosis, I've shown the pictures. And so, to conclude, an early and accurate diagnosis of amyloidosis should be the goal, and efforts should be made to elicit awareness among internists, primary care providers, cardiologists, nephrologists, neurologists, and especially our hematological colleagues, so that we can come to an early conclusion. Thank you all for your